Hello learners, I once more welcome you all in my lecture series on modern optics for physics 1. Myself Dr. Sucharita Bhattacharya, subject teacher of physics from Guru Nanak Institute of Technology, Kolkata, is delivering my lecture session for first semester BTech course, and the students under consideration are from streams of computer science and engineering, information technology and food technology. Today I am going to deliver lecture 4 on modern optics. Now we are delivering the sub module 5.01 on laser, where we have to discuss total 5 lectures covering all the contents. Now today I am going to deliver my 4th lesson on laser. Here I will discuss on various laser systems in the form of ruby laser and the helium neon laser. Naturally, the questions to be addressed in today's session: what about various laser systems? What is ruby laser? What about its various components and working? What is helium neon laser? And what is its various components and working? That means basically today I will cover two specific laser systems. One is the ruby laser and the other is the helium neon laser. Now let us start our today's session. Now ruby laser actually is a first laser which was fabricated successfully by my man and co-workers way back in 1916. And it was a 3-level solid state laser. Construction wise, it is made from a single cylindrical crystal of ruby rod whose ends are flat and with one of the ends completely silvered and the other partially silvered, which forms the optical resonator or resonant cavity. So this is the single cylindrical crystal of the ruby rod whose ends are kept flat with one of the ends completely silvered and the other partially silvered. So as per our requirement of the basic components, the optical resonator or resonator cavity is formed here. Now what about ruby? Ruby basically consists of aluminium oxide crystal, where some of the aluminium atoms are replaced by chromium. Aluminium is trivalent, chromium is also trivalent. Now the aluminium oxide crystal, which serves as a medium to suspend the chromium ions, is the host crystal, and the chromium is the active material. So just take a look, you are very much familiar with the ruby. In the jewelry you have seen it. This is the characteristic color of the ruby. How to get that characteristic color? I am coming to that point. But before that, just take a look. Ruby is nothing but aluminium oxide crystal, where few of the aluminium are replaced by the trivalent chromium. And aluminium is considered to be the host crystal because it suspends the active material, that is the chromium. Now, when the ruby crystal contains only 0.05% of the chromium, that means aluminium, when replaced by chromium of 0.05% only, its color becomes pink. So characteristic color we used to get. Now these type of ruby crystals are grown in special furnaces whose length and the diameter you can vary. Most commonly used ruby rod, it is of length 4 cm and diameter 0.5 cm. So very, very small, you are getting the idea. Now, what about the working? Before that, we have to be very, very careful about the pumping mechanism. During the discussion on the pumping for various type of lasers, I gave you the message for solid state laser, it is the optical pumping. Now ruby being a solid state laser, how optical pumping work here for achieving population inversion? Let us now take a look. Ruby rod is surrounded by a helical xenon field flash tube. This is the ruby rod, already we have seen. It is surrounded by a helical xenon gas field flash tube, which provides the pumping light to raise the chromium to upper energy level. That means to achieve the population inversion. So how it is done? This is the original setup of Myman. This is the figure like that. In the original setup, the xenon gas field tube is connected with a capacitor. Is connected with a capacitor which is charged to few kilovolts. The capacitor is connected to the xenon field gas tube, which is charged to few kilovolts. That means the energy stored there is several thousand joules. During the charging, the capacitor can store the energy of few thousand joules, and during the discharging process, the capacitor will discharge through the xenon tube this huge amount of energy, and it will be discharged through a few milliseconds. That means flash of light will come out, and this results in a power output of few megawatt. Just take a look. This is a new type of pumping mechanism. The ruby rod is surrounded by helical xenon field gas tube, which is connected to a capacitor, and capacitor is charged to few kilovolts. Now, during the discharge, the several thousand joules of energy which is stored in the capacitor during charging will be passed through the xenon field gas tube within few milliseconds, resulting in a power output of few megawatt within such a short interval of time. That means the output we will get in the form of a flash lamp. Okay. Now, the xenon tube consumes several thousand joules of energy, I already mentioned. Only a part of this is used in pumping the active material chromium to its higher energy state to have the population inversion. Naturally, it will be excited and subsequent lasing action will take place. And the rest of the energy will heat up the apparatus. So, the setup requires an elaborate cooling arrangement. So, the several thousand joules of energy when passed through the xenon tube in the form of flash lamp, then the active material, that is chromium inside the ruby, only will consume very small amount of energy because its percentage is only 0.05% within the host crystal Al2O3. So, what about the chromium? It will absorb the energy and it will move to higher energy excited state to have the population inversion and then followed by the subsequent lasing action. But the rest amount of the energy coming out of the xenon obviously will heat up the apparatus. So the setup requires a cooling arrangement. Now, one very, very important point to consider here, a stage is reached when the population inversion caused by one flash of xenon tube is used up. The laser beam then ceases till the next flash of xenon tube repeats the process. Why it is happening? Because here, for the pumping, you are using the capacitor. It's charging and discharging through the xenon flash tube. Okay. Now, during the charging of the capacitor will not be able to supply any type of energy to xenon tube because it is now storing the energy. But during the discharging of the capacitor, the stored huge amount of energy of the order of several thousand joules, it will pass through the xenon and then the energy will be supplied. So during the charging of the capacitor, there will be no laser output. But during the discharging of the capacitor, there will be the laser output. So ruby laser is a pulse laser. Ruby laser is a pulse laser. So, when the population inversion is made, then only you will get the laser output. But when population inversion is used up, you have to wait for the next flash of the xenon tube to repeat the process. That's why ruby laser is a pulse laser. So I think you understood what about the pumping mechanism here and what about the optical resonator and the active material. Clear? Let us now move to the energy level diagram of the ruby laser. Now just take a look. This is the energy level diagram of the ruby laser. More specifically, it is the energy level diagram of the active material, that is the chromium. Here we are getting G, the ground state of the chromium. Then we are having two excited energy states in the form of energy bands. Why in the form of energy bands you are getting them? Because energy states of the chromium ion are interacting with the lattice of the aluminium oxide, because that is the host crystal and it is large in proportion compared to the chromium. So chromium will interact with large number of aluminium molecule and their energy states will be broadened to form the energy bands E1 and E2. Okay. Now, the chief characteristics of the energy levels of chromium is the fact that the bands marked T1 and E2 are regular excited state with lifetimes of the order of 10 nanoseconds, that is 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. Now, in addition to E1 and E2, there is an energy state M, basically made up of two closely spaced energy states, which is the metastable state, whose lifetime is of the order of 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 seconds. So, in addition to E1 and E2, the energy bands, the chromium has a pair of energy states in the form of the metastable energy level with lifetime of the order of 10 to the power minus 3 seconds. Okay. So, this is the specialty of the energy level diagram of the ruby laser, more specifically its active material, that is the chromium. So, these are in the range of 10 nanosecond lifetime and their bands, and this is the metastable state, a pair of energy states whose lifetime is 10 to the power minus 3 seconds. Now, how it works? The chromium ion, obviously in the ground state, can absorb a photon of wavelength 6600 angstrom to make a transition to one of the states of the band E1 by optical pumping, where the photons absorbed by the chromium are produced by the flash lamp. When the flash lamp is working, the huge amount of energy is coming out and the chromium will absorb the energy as per the requirement of its energy level bands. So, chromium atoms will absorb the energy from ground state, from optical pumping or the flash lamp. And if the absorbing wavelength is 6600 angstrom, it will raise to one of the states in the energy band E1. Also, it can absorb a photon of wavelength 4000 angstrom from optical pumping. In that case, it will be raised to energy states. If the chromium will be raised to one of the energy states in the energy band E2. Both are through optical pumping. So, the population inversion achievement first step. Basically, these are the stimulated absorption. These are the stimulated absorption, the first step which will be followed by the population inversion after this. So, I am repeating this portion once more. The chromium in its ground state absorbs a photon with lambda 6600 angstrom to make a transition to one of the states in E1 by optical pumping, where photons absorbed by chromium are produced by flash lamp. Already we have seen that. And mind it, in addition to this photon, 6600 angstrom wavelength, Another photon wavelength of value 4000 angstrom can also be absorbed by the chromium at the ground state to raise to the energy states of the energy band E2. Depending upon these energy values, the absorption wavelength will vary. Now take a look here. Along this direction, energy scale is increasing. Now energy means E equal to h nu equal to hc by lambda. That means energy is inversely proportional to lambda. So smaller the energy, higher is the lambda. Higher the energy, smaller is the lambda. So be careful at this point. Okay. In both cases, immediately the chromium which are excited to E1 and E2 makes a non-radiative transition to the energy states marked M, where the excess energy will be absorbed by the crystal lattice itself within 10⁻¹ because their lifetimes are 10 nanosecond or 10⁻¹. So once chromium excited to these states E1 and E2, they immediately come down to the energy states M through radiation-less transition within 10⁻¹, where the extra energy is absorbed by the crystal lattice itself. Then what is happening? Now, M is a metastable state. So the chromium, which are coming down from A1 and A2 through radiation-less transition, will accumulate at the energy states M. So number of chromium in the energy states M goes on increasing compared to the ground state. So a state of population inversion will be achieved between M and G. A state of population inversion is achieved between the energy states M and G. And under this condition, the light amplification will take place with the reflecting ends of the ruby rod forming the optical resonator cavity. And obviously, through stimulated emission, after population inversion through stimulated emission, the fluorescence will come out in the form of wavelength 6943 angstrom from the lower one and 6927 angstrom from the upper one. Both are comes under the category of the red wavelength region of the ruby laser. They give the characteristic red output of the ruby laser. So I think you are understanding this, that this is the stimulated absorption, then spontaneous emission, and then stimulated emission. Through stimulated absorption, you are raising the atoms. Through spontaneous emission, the atoms are accumulated at M, where the stage of population inversion is achieved between them and the ground state. And then you are getting the stimulated emission and the lasing action will take place. Just the standard way we should do it. So this is the way the ruby laser works, giving you the red output in the range of 6943 angstrom and 6927 angstrom. So I hope the steps are very, very clear to all of you, isn't that? Now let us move to the four-level laser system. So I already mentioned that ruby laser is the first laser fabricated successfully. Now that was three-level laser, and that was the solid state laser. It is the four-level laser and it is the gas laser in the form of helium neon, and it was fabricated by Ali Jabhan and co-workers at Bell Telephone Laboratories, USA. Okay, now let us come to the construction part. Basically, helium neon laser, the name suggests that the material under consideration is a mixture of helium and neon in the ratio of 10:1, kept inside a long narrow discharge tube at a pressure of only 1 millimeter of mercury. So pressure is very, very small, 1 millimeter of mercury. It is kept inside a long narrow discharge tube. Okay. Now, the two electrodes of the discharge tube are connected to a high voltage DC source, and the gas system is enclosed between a pair of plane mirrors or curved mirrors, forming the optical resonator or the resonant cavity. Definitely one of the mirror is highly reflecting by being fully silvered and the other partially transmitting, so that amplified output can be taken out through this. So just consider the difference between the previous one and this one. Here the gas system is a material which is kept inside a long narrow discharge tube, okay? And the ratio of the gas, just take a look, it is 10:1 and pressure is very small, and these form the optical resonator, the two mirrors, which is different from the previous one. And here the high voltage DC source is used definitely for electric discharge to achieve the pumping. In the previous case, it was the optical pumping method through flash lamp. Clear? Now let us move to the few energy levels of helium and neon atoms as shown here. Let us first take a look here. This is the energy axis. Now here energy is expressed in 10,000 centimeter inverse unit. Energy is expressed in 10,000 centimeter inverse unit. This is the ground state. Then after that, we have truncated a portion of this axis. We have started then from 11, then 13, 15, 17, 19, and so on. Now, these are the helium energy states, which are represented by the letter F. Three energy states we have considered. F1 is the ground state, that means energy value 0. Next, we have two excited metastable state, F2 and F3. Now, with helium energy states, we have the neon energy states also shown side by side. But in case of neon, it is the letter E which represents the energy states of neon. Compared to three energy states of helium, here we have taken six energy states of neon in the form of E1, E2, E3, E4, E5, and E6. Obviously, E1 is the ground state energy level of neon. That means its energy value is obviously 0. Now, when electric discharge is passed through the system, that is the mixture of helium and neon, what will happen? Ionization will take place, and accelerated electrons, millions of electrons, the accelerated one and very light one, they will collide with lighter helium, which are present in 10 times more proportion than neon, resulting in their excitation by collision with energetic electron to energy states F2 and F3, which are metastable. That means helium atoms excited to these states, they will spend enough time in F2 and F3 before losing energy through collision with neon. The direct radiative transition from F2 and F3 to ground state for helium is forbidden. Direct radiative transition is forbidden. Just take a look. Helium is present 10 times more than neon, and helium is very light compared to neon, because helium is represented by 2 helium 4 and neon is represented by 10 neon 20. Now, because of discharge, the accelerated electrons will come out, and electrons are very light, so definitely they will collide and exchange energy successfully with lighter helium rather than neon. And helium is very large in proportion, resulting in excitation of helium to the levels marked F2 and F3, and F2 and F3 are metastable, so helium will be helium will exist there for sufficiently long time, of the order of 10 to the power minus 3 seconds, before losing energy by collision with neon. Through atomic collision, the neons from the ground state will be excited to the levels marked E4 and E6 because E4 and E6 have energy values very close to F2 and F3. E4 and E6 have energy values which are very close to F4, F2 and F3. Now, in the neighborhood of E4 and E6, we have two other energy states of neon whose energy values are lesser than E4 and E6. Now, through atomic collision by helium, neon are excited to E4 and E6, but not in E3 and E5. So, a sizable population is achieved at the states E6 and E4 rather than E3 and E5. So, a stage of population inversion will be achieved between these four energy states. A stage of population inversion is achieved between these four energy states. Now, let us take a look what I told, how to express it. When the electric discharge is passed through the gash, the electrons traveling down the tube collides with large number of helium atoms and excite them to the levels F2 and F3, which are metastable. So, atoms spend enough time there before losing energy through collision with neon. Already I mentioned, and direct radiative transitions from these states to the ground state is forbidden. And excited helium atoms colliding with neon atoms raise them to neon metastable states in the form of E4 and E6, as I mentioned, having nearly the same energy as that of the levels F2 and F3 of helium. Obviously, this results in a sizable populations of the levels E4 and E6, which happens to be much more than those in the lower levels E3 and E5. That means a state of population inversion is achieved by pumping action, which is taking place in a complex and indirect manner. Very, very important point. First thing is, what about the pumping here? Through electric discharge, as already mentioned in my first lesson on laser, that for the gas laser, it is the electric discharge to achieve pumping. Now here, the pumping mechanism is taking place in a complex and indirect manner. Why? Because through discharge from accelerated electrons, energy is transferred to the numerous and lighter helium. Then helium is accelerated and they are transferring the energy to the comparatively heavier neon atoms, which are in lesser proportions present. That means ultimately neon is being accelerated and their lasing action will take place between the energy states of neon, as will be clear to us now. But it is getting energy indirectly from the discharge, not directly, by using helium in between. Okay, so this is the complex and indirect manner. Any spontaneously emitted photon then can trigger lasing action in any of the three transitions as shown in the figure. I am going to the figure once more. So when population inversion is achieved between E4, E6 and E3, E5, any spontaneously emitted photon can trigger laser action between these energy states in the form of three transitions as shown in the figure. Look here, from E6 to E5, because of the transition, the energy output will be 3.39 micrometer. Between E4 to E3, because of the lasing action, energy output will be 1.15 micrometer. And from E6 to E3, the energy output will be of the order of 6328 angstrom, which is in the visible region. Now, when neon are coming down to the lower energy state, from there it will come down to even lower energy state E2 through spontaneous emission by emitting the radiation of wavelength 6000 angstrom. And from E2, the neon is brought back to the ground state E1. From E2, the neon is brought back to the ground state E1 by collision with the wall of the discharge tube. That means de-excitation through small amount of energy which is remaining after this stage. It is being done by collision with the wall of the discharge tube. Okay. So transition from E6 to E5, E4 to E3, and E6 to E3 results in the emission of radiation having wavelengths of 3.39 micrometer, 1.15 micrometer, and 6328 angstrom respectively. Now, out of these three possible transitions in case of helium neon laser, obviously first two are not falling under the visible region. The first two wavelengths, first two laser output in the form of wavelengths of 3.39 micrometer and 1.15 micrometer, they are not coming under the visible wavelength range. So these two are not at all visible. Only 6328 angstrom, that is from E6 to E3. E6 to E3, the transition gives us the wavelength output of 6328 angstrom. Definitely, it is the well-known red light of helium neon laser. So 6328 angstrom transition corresponds to the well-known red light of the helium neon laser. Now, neon atoms, I already mentioned, then drop down from the lower laser level to the level E2 through spontaneous emission and then brought back to the ground state by collision with the walls. So neon atom comes back to the ground state. That means the process will now continue. The process will now continue because already helium lose their energy by collision with neon and they came back to ground state. Now neon is also in the ground state. So helium ground state means the electric discharge, accelerated electrons will again excite helium and the process will continue. Here we may mention one very, very important point that in case of the ruby laser, I told that the wavelength output is in the range of red light because those were 6927 angstrom and 6943 angstrom. In case of helium neon also, we are getting the laser output in the range of 6328 angstrom. That is again in the red region. But commercially, helium neon laser is available which can give green output. So helium neon laser giving a green output is commercially available. How? Where a proper selection of different frequencies is made by choosing the end mirrors having high reflectivity over only the required wavelength range. So you are using the end mirrors to form the optical resonator. Now, depending upon your choice of wavelength output, you have to make the reflectivity of those mirrors very high over the required wavelength range. Then you can get different wavelengths also. Definitely, basically, it will depend on, very natural way, it will depend on the existence or occurrence of the energy level of the corresponding system. Depending upon the energy band gap, what amount of the emitted wavelength will come out and corresponding color will be decided. But also you can change a little bit depending upon the reflectivity of the end mirror. If you just choose it over the required wavelength range, you can change it to some extent. Now, in the last, like in the few minutes back, actually before this, I discussed the ruby laser, which is the solid state laser. And now we have got the idea about the helium neon laser. which is the gas laser. Now, what about their advantage, relative advantages and disadvantages? Obviously, the gas lasers are in general emit light, which is more directional and more monochromatic compared to the solid state laser, because certain, you can say, the disadvantages which are present in the form of crystalline impurity and imperfections, thermal distortion and the scattering in case of the solid state laser, which are not present in gas laser. So absence of crystalline impurity, imperfections, thermal distortion and the scattering which are present in solid state laser are not present in gas laser, resulting in emitted light from gas laser, which is more directional and more monochromatic. Obviously, gas lasers also are capable of operating continuously without the need for any cooling arrangement. In case of ruby laser, we have seen it is the pulsed output, but here we used to get the continuous wave output ranging from 0.5 milliwatt to 50 milliwatt, very safe range to use. Typically, continuous wave output ranging from 0.5 milliwatt to 50 milliwatt are obtained in case of helium neon laser, which is very safe to handle in laboratory experiments and also in various artistic display. So just take a look at the wavelength range, and mind it, gas laser are capable to operate continuously but without the need of any cooling arrangement. So definitely we will prefer the gas laser to use rather than the solid state laser. But mind it, ruby laser was for the first time fabricated commercially, first time fabricated successfully rather, not exactly commercially, successfully. That's why ruby laser always has a very, very special status. Ruby laser always has a very, very special status. Now, in addition to ruby laser and the helium neon laser, we have another laser to discuss in the form of the semiconductor laser. Okay. But since we have to go for a little bit recapitulation about the semiconductor physics, that's why that laser we will discuss after doing that semiconductor physics part. Clear? So for the time being, let us close our session today. I think all of you understood. And what about the comparison between the helium neon laser and the ruby laser? You got it so far as components and the working of lasers are concerned. So thank you, students. Stay safe, stay healthy. Okay. Thank you.